The story in here I had the most trouble with is this one, A Bitch in Bod. I got 2 pages into it and I thought, oh, this is just too, this is too negative, it's too twisted, it's too upsetting, I gotta stop this. So I quit working on it and I threw the pages in the garbage can. And at some point Aileen came in my studio for something and I decided, well, I'll show her this and see what she thinks about it. So I pulled them out of the garbage can. I said, Aileen, this thing, what do you think about this? I threw it away. I decided I want to continue with it. It's just too weird. It's just too disturbing. She read it and said, you have to finish this. You just have to do it. Obviously, you got to see this through. I said, well, okay, she's a woman. She said, I have to do it, so I'll do it. So Flicky Foon enters the door, and there's this girl's body standing there, but what you see is Mr. Natural's head and his beard over the front of her where her head should be. That's how it starts. Flicky Foon, he's very confused by that. And Mr. Natural comes galloping in, riding the girl around the room, and her body's very frisky, and you don't see her head at all. You just see Mr. Natural's beard over where her head should be. So then she lands in a split, and Mr. Natural starts talking about what an amazing body this woman has, but the head was always a problem because she had such an obnoxious personality. Flaky Foont is shocked and horrified when he sees that she actually doesn't have a head. And Mr. Natural explains, well, let's face it, she was obnoxious, so I just got rid of the head. And then you always wanted her, you always lusted after her, and now you can have her because her head's missing. So then he starts explaining how he took the head off and topped the neck with this little cap. And that Mr. Natural says he found out, he discovered that there was that she had a second smaller brain in her butt and that's what's making the body function. And then he gives Funk directions on how to feed her. You take this cap off and you put this funnel down her neck. And Mr. Natural pulls out this mannequin head and says, if you take her outside, you got to put this head on her so people aren't shocked and horrified by a headless girl walking around. And then Mr. Natural leaves and says, don't say I never did anything for you. He gives the girl to Funk. And Foon's kind of getting excited. He's got this frisky, wondrous girl body all to himself to do with whatever he wants. And he says, I like it better with just the cap. He knocks the fake head off. He's leading her over to the wall, and she accidentally steps on the fake head and smashes it. He pushes her against the wall, pulls her clothes off. He's admiring her firm and solid butt. This is the part where I get excited when I'm working on it. I really enjoy drawing the female form. I always make a lot of fuss and bother to make sure the figure comes out just the way I want it. The male side, I don't care what they look like that much. So he starts to fuck her. Here he penetrates her from behind, and he's getting really excited. And at the same time, he feels somewhat guilty. And then while he's in the middle of coming, he imagines her severed head and then her face condemning him. She says, you little shit. Cut to Mr. Natural. He's home. Phone's ringing. He's saying, well, got home about an hour ago. Yep, it's Funt. Yep, he's feeling guilty. Funt wants to bring her back over. He wants to get rid of her. He can't handle it. So Mr. Natural says, okay, bring her over. He says, make sure you put the head back on before you take her outside. So he goes to get the head, and he realizes it's been smashed. He doesn't know what to do.
Has anyone ever made you question your reality?
Cultural conditioning to suppress our anger.
So he ties up a t-shirt into a ball and puts it on top of the cap, and then he puts a hat on. He pushes her in the car, and we cut to Mr. Natural's house. Mr. Natural's saying he's going to regret it if he doesn't keep her. But Mr. Natural says, all right, forget it. We'll put the head back. Mr. Natural unscrews the clamp, pulls this pipe out of her, and he reaches in there. This is probably the most sickening, disturbing panel in the whole story. So he's pulling real hard, and he pulls her head back out by her tongue. Her head was actually inside her body all the time. Again, Funt is very shocked, but then he's relieved that her head is back. Mr. Natural says, yeah, old African witch doctor stuff, nothing special. And she just says, that was so weird. Mr. Natural says, yep. And they both realize, yep, the head's back, the trouble's back. She says, what happened to her and what did Mr. Natural do to her and where does he get his crazy ideas? At this point, Funti feels so guilty, he starts apologizing to the devil girl for having, like, done the deed to her when she didn't have her head. And she says, what are you saying? And she suddenly realizes that Mr. Natural had handed her over to Foon for him to play with. And she says, you gave me to that schmuck to play with as if I was a piece of meat. He says, ah, what the hell's the difference? So he tries to get away and she's chasing him. And in the end, she's raging with anger. And she says, where's a butcher knife? I'm going to cut both your heads off.
Anger is very dangerous. Makes people do stupid things.
Of all the emotions, anger stands out as one of the most powerful and certainly the most destructive. Rage, resentment, chronic hostility, and hatred are all forms of anger which, if allowed to persist, can result in intense personal suffering, harm to those close to us, and even death on a mass scale. In the 20th century, hundreds of millions of people died at the hands of political movements which fed off the resentment of the masses, a fact that should wake us up to the peril of ignoring our anger. Yet not all anger is pathological and destructive. Sometimes anger is a warranted response to mistreatment.
What civilization is 6 billion people trying to make themselves happy by standing on each other's shoulders and kicking each other's teeth in. It's not a pleasant situation. And yet, you can stand back and look at this planet and see that we have the money, the power, the medical understanding, the scientific know-how, the love, and the community to produce the kind of human paradise. But we are led by the least among us, the least intelligent, the least noble, the least visionary. We're led by the least among us, and we do not fight back against the dehumanizing values that are handed down as control icons. This is something, I mean, I don't really want to get off on this tear because it's a lecture in itself, but culture is not your friend. Culture is for other people's convenience and the convenience of various institutions, churches, companies, tax collection schemes, what have you. It is not your friend. It insults you. It disempowers you. It uses and abuses you. None of us are well treated by culture. And yet we glorify, you know, the creative potential of the individual, the rights of the individual. We understand the felt presence of experience is what is most important, but the culture is a perversion. It fetishizes objects, creates consumer mania, it preaches endless forms of false happiness, endless forms of false understanding in the form of swirly religions and silly cults. It invites people to diminish themselves and dehumanize themselves by behaving like machines.
And this knowledge, which we have acquired through our senses, and therefore connected with the brain, this knowledge man acquired is now being transferred to the computer. I do not know if you are aware of all this. The computer can do everything that man can do. It can learn. It has been programmed as our brain is programmed to be a Catholic, to be a Protestant, to be a Hindu, to be a Buddhist. You understand all this? Of course, if you pay, your brain is programmed. Whether you like it or not, you have to observe it. Otherwise, you won't call yourself Hindu or a communist. Your brain has been cultivated through time, and through that, and time, which is the acquisition of experience, knowledge, so on and so on, that brain has been programmed, has been conditioned to respond according to certain reactions. This is inevitable. That brain is now being is being given over to the computer. Please realize this. The computer is becoming your brain, the human brain.
We're bored. We're all bored now. But has it ever occurred to you, Wally, that the process that creates this boredom that we see in the world now may very well be a self-perpetuating, unconscious form of brainwashing created by a world totalitarian government based on money, and that all of this is much more dangerous than one thinks? And it's not just a question of individual survival, Wally, but that somebody who's bored is asleep, and somebody who's asleep will not say no?
And even rage can be to our benefit if our life is in peril. Those who do not show anger at things that ought to arouse anger are regarded as fools, wrote Aristotle. Anger can also provide us with the energy and self-assertiveness required to transform ourselves, attain our goals, and engage in constructive activity. Anger is a sign that something within us wants to live and affirm itself, while its antithesis, apathy, signifies that a will to death has overcome us. At birth, we are thrown into a reality which can be unwelcoming, frustrating, and hostile to our desires. The helplessness we feel in the face of the cold indifference of reality is worsened by the fact that, although we do our best to desperately deny it, deep down we know that our primal desire to perpetuate ourselves is doomed to fail. Death lies waiting for us all. "Do not go gentle into that good night," wrote the poet Dylan Thomas. "Rage, rage against the dying of the light." Yet despite anger being a natural and sometimes healthy response to feelings of powerlessness, most of us have been culturally conditioned to suppress our anger. We have devised intricate social rituals to maintain a common altruistic self-image behind which we hide the anger and resentment which dwells within. And in so doing, we have made ourselves psychologically unstable.
Have you ever heard a lie so unrealistic that it seems improbable someone would actually use it? So improbable that you start wondering maybe you're missing something or misremembering a story? Has anyone ever made you question your reality? Have you ever been gaslighted? This is another field guide to bad behavior. Let's explore how to navigate the wilderness of human nature.
Gaslighting is a form of emotional abuse and thought manipulation with the aim of planting doubts in the mind of a person or group of people to make them question their own memory and perception of reality.
The one place in which gods and demons inarguably exist is in the human mind, where they are real in all their grandeur and monstrosity. Much of magic, as I understand it, in the Western occult tradition, is the search for the self with a capital S. This is understood as being the great work, as being the gold that alchemists sought, as being the will, the soul, the thing that we have inside us that is behind the intellect, the body, the dreams. The inner dynamo of us, if you like. Now, this is the single most important thing that we can ever attain, the knowledge of our own self. And yet there are a frightening amount of people who seem to have the urge not just to ignore the self, but actually seem to have the urge to obliterate themselves. This is horrific, but you can almost understand the desire to simply wipe out that awareness because it's too much of a responsibility to actually possess such a thing as a soul, such a precious thing. What if you break it? What if you lose it? Mightn't it be best to anesthetize it, to deaden it, to destroy it?
This is probably one of the last comic covers Charles ever did. It might even be the very last one, is Psychotic Bunny Rabbits. In our late teens, I persuaded Charles that we should send away for the famous artist talent test. He used to have these ads in magazines, so we each sent away for this test, and I did mine completely legitimately the way you were supposed to, but Charles couldn't help himself. You're supposed to complete the outline figure by drawing a costume on it, but he put these pasties on her tits and then started drawing these weird psychotic characters in the background, psychotic Mickey Mouse. They had an outline of this barn and this tree, and you're supposed to, you know, drawing textures and surfaces, and they give you suggestions on how to fill in the textures and all that. So that's his interpretation of that. And here was your ability to arrange elements in a picture. They give you these objects. You're supposed to make an arrangement. So he did this and this. Your imagination as an illustrator. Complete the picture by adding whatever other figures and objects you think are necessary.
Can bring to bear upon his existence
the topic of our topics.
That's the universal knowledge.
Stranger. Psychotic bunny rabbits.
The desire to simply wipe out. This is understood as being a great work.
Has anyone ever made you question your reality?
Cultural condition to suppress our anger.
He was pretty far gone at that point already. Yes, this is some of his later work after sort of the end of his comic period, 1961. He's about 18, started developing this weird wrinkle technique in his drawing. Became stranger and stranger. This is some of the last Treasure Island stuff he did. This is like late 61. It's like sort of beautifully drawn away, except the wrinkle stuff really gets out of hand here. I'm more and more obsessed with that. It gets real dark looking. They had this fascination with the relationship between the kid and Long John Silver, the pirate character, which he elaborated on endlessly. This is one of our two mans. You can see that he's gradually has more and more text, you know, the writing takes over. Look at that. He's just lost interest in drawing. And then he just went to this loony writing.
The story of the Archons is similar to what Don Juan talked about in The Active Side of Infinity by Carlos Castaneda. Ah, that's the universe at large, Don Juan said. Incommensurable, non-linear, outside the realm of syntax. The sorcerers of ancient Mexico were the first ones to see those fleeting shadows, so they followed them around. They saw them as you're seeing them, and they saw them as energy that flows in the universe. And they did discover something transcendental. They discovered that we have a companion for life. We have a predator that came from the depths of the cosmos and took over the rule of our lives. Human beings are its prisoners. The predator is our lord and master. It has rendered us docile, helpless. If we want to protest, it suppresses our protest. If we want to act independently, it demands that we don't do so. You have arrived, by your efforts alone, to what the shamans of ancient Mexico called the topic of all topics. I have been beating around the bush all the time, insinuating to you that something is holding us prisoner. Indeed, we are held prisoner. That was an energetic fact for the sorcerers of ancient Mexico. Why has this predator taken over in the fashion that you are describing, Don Juan? I asked. There must be a logical explanation. There is an explanation, Don Juan replied, which is the simplest explanation in the world. They took over because we are food for them, and they squeeze us mercilessly because we are their sustenance. Just as we rear chickens in chicken coops, the predators rear us in human coops. Therefore, their food is always available to them. No, 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 I heard myself saying. That is absurd, Don Juan. What you're saying is something monstrous. It simply can't be true, for sorcerers or for average men, or for anyone. Why not? Don Juan asked calmly. Why not? Because it infuriates you? Yes, it infuriates me, I retorted. Those claims are monstrous. I want to appeal to your analytical mind, Don Juan said. Think for a moment and tell me how you would explain the contradiction between the intelligence of man, the engineer, and the stupidity of his systems of beliefs, or the stupidity of his contradictory behavior. Sorcerers believe that the predators have given us our systems of beliefs, our ideas of good and evil, our social mores. They are the ones who set up our hopes and expectations and dreams of success or failure. They have given us covetousness, greed and cowardice. It is the predators who make us complacent, routinary and egomaniacal. But how can they do this, Don Juan? I asked, somehow angered further by what he was saying. Do they whisper all that in our ears while we are asleep? No, they don't do it that way. That's idiotic, Don Juan said, smiling. They are infinitely more efficient and organized than that. In order to keep us obedient and meek and weak, the predators engage themselves in a stupendous maneuver. Stupendous, of course, from the point of view of a fighting strategist. A horrendous maneuver from the point of view of those who suffer it. They gave us their mind. Do you hear me? The predators gave us their mind, which becomes our mind. The predator's mind is baroque, contradictory, morose, filled with the fear of being discovered any minute now. I know that even though you have never suffered hunger, you have food anxiety, which is none other than the anxiety of the predator who fears that any moment now its maneuver is going to be uncovered and food is going to be denied. Through the mind, which after all is their mind, the predators inject into the lives of human beings whatever is convenient for them. And they ensure, in this manner, a degree of security to act as a buffer against their fear.
Hey guys, and I'm here from the Nagual Zone. Let's talk about the machine mind. The machine mind. One of the main differences, perhaps the only difference, between a warrior, a well-honed, trained warrior, and the average man, is that the warrior can function, can bring to bear upon his existence other resources than the paltry, disjointed resource that we know we exist in, that could be called the machine mind.
Ты, товарищ мой, не попомнила стороне глухой, скорони меня.
Судя по твоим напорёгам, видно, что ты сидел в Сибири. И что ты был вором.
Отец мой на дядю бы трачил. Начальство мужчины чинил. Мне 15 было, когда я начал запчасти продавать.
Тебя насильно накалывали?
Ни разу.
А с комом ты воимел?
В карцере гнил не раз.
Ты в питерских крестах сидел?
Дюжина ходов в СИЗО. Меня звали Пень за упрямство.
детства был сукой фраер, что во власти в яму. Так?
Точно. Отец мне никто. А мать?
Нет у тебя матери. Один херен лет была.
Да.
Aiden. You have come for me. What is wrong? You have come to take me. Have you not? Wait. Believe. No! No! Wait. 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 Look at me. No.
Nothing left to do.
Are you sure? Perhaps he simply didn't care for the girl.
Are you listening to me? His master's daughter was presented to him as a whore, and he did nothing. He cares for nothing. Not honor, not his family, not himself. And certainly not you.
At last, I'm free of this. Well done. Well done.
where the urns are buried.
Sacrificed. We have waited for the right moment. And now, it is time.
Actually inside her body all the time. That was so weird. Mr. Natural said, yep, the trouble's back. Where does he get his crazy ideas? Where's a butcher knife? I'm going to cut both your heads off.
Sometimes anger is a warranted response to mistreatment.
Makes people do stupid things.
That we have the money, the power, the medical understanding, the scientific know-how, the love, and the community to produce the kind of human paradise. Culture is not your friend. It disempowers you, it uses and abuses you. The culture is a perversion. It fetishizes objects, creates consumer mania, it preaches endless forms of false happiness, endless forms of false understanding in the form of swirly religions and silly cults. Behaving like machines.
The computer is becoming your brain.
Be a self-perpetuating, unconscious form of brainwashing.
And even rage can be to our benefit if our life is in peril, required to transform ourselves. Something within us wants to live and affirm itself, hostile to our desires. Death lies waiting for us all. Most of us have been culturally conditioned to suppress our anger.
It seems improbable someone would actually use it. Has anyone ever made you question your reality?
In the human mind, where they are real in all their grandeur and monstrosity. This is understood as being the great work, as being the gold that alchemists sought, the thing that we have inside us that is behind the intellect, the body, the dreams, the inner dynamo of us, if you like. This is the single most important thing that we can ever attain. Actually seem to have the urge to obliterate themselves. The desire to simply wipe out that awareness.
This is probably one of the last comic covers Charles ever did.
What he did? He flipped my entire model over. How much work I put into that thing?
Psychotic bunny rabbits. But he put these pasties on her tits and then started drawing these weird psychotic characters in the background. Psychotic Mickey Mouse. stranger and stranger. It gets real dark looking. He's lost interest in drawing, and then he just went to this loony writing.
Ah, that's the universe at large, Don Juan said. Incommensurable, non-linear, outside the realm of syntax. They discovered that we have a companion for life. We have a predator that came from the depths of the cosmos and took over the rule of our lives. You have arrived, by your efforts alone, to what the shamans of ancient Mexico called the topic of all topics, because we are their sustenance. The predators gave us their mind, which becomes our mind.
The warrior can function, can bring to bear upon his existence other resources than the paltry, disjointed resource that we know we exist in, that could be called the machine mind.
We have planned, we have sacrificed, we have waited for the right moment. And now, it is time.